also is the president of their skeptic group there, and he's joining us today to talk about a new law that's put in place to fight against, well, what he calls here, the committee, he's the president of the Committee for Eradication of Superstition, and let's welcome all the way from India, Dr. Shantanu. Members for giving me a chance to be here speaking to you. It's been a very interesting time and we've been enjoying the conference for the past few days. Thank you so much. I'm here to narrate a tale of victory overshadowed by an assassination. The Maharashtra Andhashraddha Nirmoolan Samiti, roughly translated as Committee for Eradication of Superstition. Let me put it into perspective. Where we are from and what have we been doing all these years. It was in 1989 that Dr. Narendra Dabholkar, whose picture you see here, he gave up his medical practice and formed the Maharashtra Andhashraddha Nirmoolan Samiti. It's popularly known as ANISA, that is the acronym in the colloquial language Marathi. And I hence on refer to this particular organization as ANISA. So ANISA has been fighting and exposing godmen and charlatans, challenging their miracles. We also have a prize money of amounting to $30,000 to anybody who proves supernatural claims, and a prize like James Randi's prize remains unclaimed for the past 30 years now. We have fought astrologers, we have fought soothsayers, and people selling lucky gems and feng shui and vastu shastra. The list is very, very long. We have pecked at and picked up traditional practices which were not eco-friendly. In fact, we just celebrated the eco-friendly Ganesha festival and the upcoming Diwali festival. It was a tradition to burst crackers in public places which created a lot of noise pollution. But through our efforts, the festival is now rather silent. And we have had a resounding success in bringing down the noise levels in Diwali, I must say. We have been trying to inculcate scientific temper in school kids through examinations, which are not just based on their curriculum. Where India is a country beset with caste divisions, and finding a proper match, it basically depends on what caste the other person belongs to. So we've been fighting that because the committee sincerely believes that caste happens to be the greatest superstition. We have a monthly publication, a Varta Patra, which I must share with you, carried the translation of Richard Dawkins's The Magic of Reality, and it found a large readership which was followed up every month. As we challenge superstitions and miracles and godmen and godwomen, and we tried to bring them to book, we garnered a lot of experience and became well conversant with the lacunae in the system, fighting exploitation, sexploitation, inhuman rites and rituals, fighting powerful self-professed men of religion with brainwashed followers of plenty is no easy goal. The keepers of the law and public order themselves were genuflecting in front of these miracle men. They often had a soft corner for these so-called sadhus and babas and saints and helped them with loopholes in the law, or they sought to weaken the evidence or tampered with it to suit the culprits. Democracy also means that public figures will usually toe the popular line. For fear of alienating potential voters, ANISA rarely received strong political backing. We also realized that the judiciary too had a limited insight into the problem and often went by the letter rather than the spirit of the law. Few understood that superstitions formed the very core of many crimes, and perpetuating superstitions would actually harm the society at large. Under such circumstances, we demanded an anti-superstition act. Many hardly saw any role for legal succor. Most believed that literacy, education and affluence will usher in the awakening necessary, and the evil, inhuman, ghastly practices will vanish like a miracle. However, our experience with the existing system and existing laws, we found that they were woefully inadequate to deal with certain peculiar situations. We did try. In certain situations, we invoked the Drugs and Magic Practices, Magic Remedies Act. But then we found that it was limited to objectionable advertisements and punishment almost was notional and conviction rarely ever happened. India has a penal provision against cheating, but cheating was interpreted mostly as financial losses in Ponzi schemes. And investigating agencies, courts and executives rarely if ever interpreted it more broadly than this and simply refused to apply it to religious practices. Often when persons claim miracle cure, we lodge complaints under the Medical Practitioners Act, but the act deals mainly with the misdemeanors of the registered or the qualified medical practitioners. While the act reined in qualified medical practitioners for making outlandish claims, it had no power to stop others from claiming anything, right from cure for AIDS or even cancer, just as we heard from our Brazilian friend. Now we have an act against bogus doctors in Maharashtra, that is the state where we belong to. So we began a long struggle. It was on 8th August 1989, almost 30 years ago, that the Committee for Eradication of Superstition, that is ANISA, was formed, and we soon demanded an act. In 1991, the first draft was presented to the government. Nothing happened, and after 10 long years of demand and protest, in 1999, the government promised enactment within 2 years. But still nothing materialized. After 2 years, all that we could extract from the government was more assurance. In 2003, things appeared to be moving. The then Chief Minister suggested that we change the name of the Act from Anti-Superstition Act to Eradication of Evil Practices and Black Magic Act. Now, this was to stem the long, fruitless philosophical debates about what is belief, and what is superstition, and what is acceptable, and what is not. The Cabinet actually approved the Act on 4th of August 2003, and on 15th August, which is our Indian Independence Day, the government flashed advertisements all over the newspapers, claiming it to be the first government, the first state government to have a progressive act like this. But it was just that. The necessary next step of having the act tabled in the legislature and passing it by majority, that never happened. In fact, 2 years later, on 13th of April 2005, when the concerned minister tried to table the act, the minister was prevented by rowdy members of the legislature, the opposition members as well as the ruling party members, and the house was adjourned, adjournment was forced, and the government had to postpone the enactment. In July, the government readied a watered-down version of the act after prolonged committee meetings with right-wing representatives and leaders. But to our great surprise, as the agitation got traction and luminaries from various fields in the state wrote to the Chief Minister and his deputy, the upper house demanded a vetting of the act by a joint legislative review committee. Now, this was nothing but procrastination. The act was all the time on the agenda of the house, but only just. It was never tabled officially. Certain religious groups kept on protesting, and even after 20 amendments were made to pacify them, still the act could not go through the necessary legal procedures. Come April 2013, the cabinet approved the act for the sixth time. All the time this kept on happening. The cabinet would approve the act, but it would never be tabled in the house. So the cabinet approved the act for the sixth time, and in July the same year, the committee, that is ANISA, published a black paper as against a white paper exposing the double speak and the procrastination by the government. ANISA and its volunteers boldly faced backlash throughout the agitation period. ANISA was deliberately misquoted. A misinformation campaign was unleashed. Propaganda drummed up. Mass hysteria was whipped up. There were court cases, and we were accused of being the agents of the West, being funded by the West. Spurious complaints, court cases, threats, attacks, disruptions of rationalist meetings continued to foul the atmosphere. But we pressed on, always through legal, Gandhian, democratic, non-violent and constitutional yet novel ways of protest. Like volunteers would go to government offices and slap themselves to underline the insensitivity of the government. Things came to such a head that on 20th of August 2013, the founder president of the organization, Dr. Narendra Dabholkar, was assassinated while he was on a morning walk. This shocked everybody, the proponents as well as the opponents, and something unprecedented happened. There was a groundswell of support for the ideas and ideals of Dr. Narendra Dabholkar, and less than a week from the assassination, the government issued an ordinance declaring its firm resolve to bring in the law. And finally, in December 2013, the ordinance was converted into the law when the House passed this particular motion by a voice vote. So, we had a victory, of course, but after the leader who actually fought the most was felled in this particular unfortunate situation. Coming to the Act has a schedule listing 12 specific deeds and practices, propagation or promotion of which is a cognizable, non-bailable offence. It also lists practices clearly out of the ambit of the Act, deeds that are not deemed to be black magic, inhuman or aghori, that is the term that is used in the Act, to prevent any misinterpretation of the law that might restrict religious freedom. The Indian Constitution allows you to believe in any god, any religion and anything. So let's go through the list of offences. According to the Act, to whiplash, to suffocate with fumes, to otherwise cause pain or harm, to force exhibitionist sexual act, to make one consume excreta so as to exorcise the person is a crime. The Act also says that it denounces display of so-called miracles to earn money, deceive or defraud or terrorize people as a crime. Following any inhuman or aghori practices to receive blessings from a supernatural power is a crime. So it's a very, very progressive Act, and I guess USA should copy it. Performing acts, including human sacrifice to divine water, to seek hidden treasure, etc., is a violation of the Act. Claims of having been possessed by a power inapprehensible by the senses, that are the exact words that are used in the law. So claims of having been possessed by a power inapprehensible by the senses, thereby threatening evil consequences if the wishes of such a person are declined, is a crime. Canvassing powers of witchcraft, black magic, claiming to diminish milk yielding cattle by such powers, or declaring someone a witch or a Satan, Satan incarnate, claiming that the person brings misfortune, illness or such other troubles is an offense. Because social ostracization of women and declaring women as witches is a common practice. And the committee went through some of the cases and we found that most of the time the reasons for such practices were economic. Somebody wanted to have the property of the family back in the family and such other things. Anyway, ostracizing, boycotting, parading a person naked in public is a crime. Now we also have a separate act against social ostracization based on caste, again in Maharashtra. Invoking ghosts, souls through chants of mantra. We saw that Banerjee doing it yesterday. Invoking ghost souls through chants of mantra, claiming breath of powers inapprehensible by the senses, preventing a person from seeking medical treatment under such guise, causing physical or financial harm is a crime. Preventing a person with a dog or snake bite or a scorpion bite from seeking medical aid and offering cure through chants, amulets, etc. is also a crime. India has the highest number of snake bite deaths in spite of the fact that there is an anti-snake venom available. Claiming to perform surgery with bare hands, claiming to change the sex of the fetus in utero is a crime as well. Claiming to be a couple or a paramour in the earlier incarnation, or offering to treat infertility and thereby sexually exploiting a person is a crime. To claim supernatural powers on behalf of a mentally challenged person and thus exploiting others is a crime. It has been 5 long years that we have had this act, and in the last 5 years, more than 500 complaints have been registered. The Indian legal system is rather slow. 10 of these have reached their legal conclusion, and in all 10 cases, we've had convictions. So this is 100%. I must also tell you that more than 80% of the victims in these cases are women. And that is because women are at the lowest rung of the social ladder and the economic ladder, and they are the ones who are, you know, exposed or most vulnerable to exploitation through religion and so many other practices. So it's also a law that leads to women's emancipation. Of course, we have had the law. So what next? Now, of course, we plan to find like-minded organizations like the CSI. We have networked with like-minded organizations in India and demanded a similar law in 10 different states. There are 32 in all, but we demanded a law in 10 different states. The state of Karnataka already has a law in place just like Maharashtra. Karnataka is the state with Bengaluru as its capital. So we have a law there. We also are demanding a central legislation regarding this. We intend to fight pseudoscience, especially pseudo-medicine, because that is what causes a lot of harm. Charlatans have also changed their ways. Now, hardly anybody claims any miracle in Maharashtra. They go to neighboring states and do it. And irrational medical practices are now disguised as Ayurveda. That is our traditional system of medicine. Anyway, it is this far that we have come. And I extend my invitation to all of you, organizers and participants alike, to come and attend a conference which is scheduled sometime in August, that is 9th, 10th and 11th of August in Mumbai, to mark 30 years of skeptical activism by the Andhashraddha Nirmoolan Samiti. Thank you so much.